Thanks. For the last name of Wu, I'm always last, so I'm not used to this. Thank you. I mean, I walked in here and I realized that there's an extremely dedicated, committed group of parents who are here, especially Saturday at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I've asked the people in the hotel to lower temperature to 15 degrees this morning to keep you awake and also distract you from how beautiful it is outside. You know, our hospital has got an epilepsy surgery program, which I was very fortunate to be part of. And one of the things when we started the program about 7 years ago was trying to figure out what's the orthopedic consequences of people who have hemispherectomy. And we started doing a literature search through PubMed. We found there were actually zero articles talking about the orthopedic aspects after hemispherectomy in children with seizure disorder. And it's rather frustrating. So when you go and you bring your child to see an orthopedic surgeon for a consultation, they're going to be faced with the same kind of information that I found on the internet, which is basically nothing. I want to try to give you basically in about 45 minutes or so where we come from, where orthopedic surgeons come from, when you bring a child to see them, in terms of where our sphere of thinking is and how our approach is to a child. Now, orthopedic surgery, in terms of pediatrics, is primarily dealing with the crooked child. So cerebral palsy and treating children who've got deformities of the limbs is basically bread and butter with orthopedic surgery. Many orthopedic surgeons who train in pediatric surgery are very comfortable with cerebral palsy. So when they speak to you in terms of how they manage your child, they're going to speak with a trend towards what they think about cerebral palsy. So that is basically the reference point for which that is. So I want to go through some terminology, some orthopedic terminology. I was asked to speak about hemiplegia. Hemiplegia, if you think about it, actually refers to stroke, where you're paralyzed. And in children who've had hemispherectomy, so they're not really paralyzed, they're weak. So it's probably more fair to talk about what happens to our children in terms of them not being hemiplegic, but hemiparetic, which is probably a more appropriate term that reflects the weakness of purposeful movement that results after the surgery. Now, we don't see this sometimes because the children are very spastic, and sometimes that spasticity gives them some functional support to their leg. Whether or not that's meaningful motor movement or not, that's where the weakness comes in. So to be fair, I think we talk about hemiplegia, we're really talking about hemiparesis. So you're going to see me talking more about hemiparesis rather than hemiplegia, because that's kind of more accurate. So as you know, spasticity really is a motor disorder characterized by hyperreflexia. Reflexes are very, very active. And you'll notice that when you range your child's legs, if you range them very quickly, there's going to be a lot of reflexive fight as they fight against you. But if you pull them slowly or stretch them slowly, they'll give. And that's one of the hallmarks of spasticity, is that it's velocity dependent. And the faster you range them, the faster you stretch that muscle, the more it fights back against you. And that's a function of the reflex arc that we all have in our muscles and our spinal cords. In fact, any dysfunction of the central nervous system will give you spasticity. So this, by no means, is a reflection of just post-surgery, but also can be due to acquired seizure disorder, or if your child has pre-existing injury from an oxygen brain injury or from seizure disorder and they have cerebral palsy, this also will give them the same spasticity. So when we try to talk to people about spasticity, it's hard for us to describe it unless we talk about basically a muscular tug of war. So when you and I move our arms and legs, we take it for granted that our joints move supplely. But that doesn't happen automatically. Actually, what happens when we move our elbow back and forth, one muscle has to relax and give for the other muscle to move the arm. But for somebody who's spastic, that's a muscular tug of war where nobody wins. And that's a problem. So rather than talking about people being spastic, it's like the tone never gets any less. We're not really spastic, we're hypertonic. That's probably better. This idea of a hypertonicity really is variable. It changes from moment to moment and day by day. Your child have good days, good moments, bad moments. It will fluctuate. It will never be the same any day and every day. Hypertonicity or spasticity is very much modulated by the child's environment. And as you know, if your child's upset, cold, hungry, tired or excited, their tone goes up, right? And also, as they grow in a growth spurt, their tone may get worse. When they go through puberty, their tone may change. And also, if they're immobile, their tone will also get worse. And conversely, anything which you can do to improve their environment will decrease their tone, such as regular sleep, keep them warm, right? Warm, comfortable, well-fed. and also keeping them mobile. So of course, the worst thing you can do is tickle somebody who has hypertonicity because they can't pull away from you. And the more you tickle them, the more stress goes up, the more they can't move. So it's very cruel to try to tickle somebody who can't pull away, which is one of those things. But when we sit in these chairs, and when we stand, when I stand, you have to understand that there is a partial degree of muscle tone that you and I exert just to keep our heads up, to keep our trunks up, and keep our legs locked, okay? And that ability for us to be able to stand and sit and hold our heads up requires partial relaxation of our muscles. And when we have a problem with that mobile tone, this is where things go awry in terms of your child's ability to stand and walk after surgery. When you combine that with the fact that your child is growing, now that gets even worse because you combine hypertonicity with weakness and they grow, they start getting contracted. And the faster they grow, kids have got two growth spurts, one around age 5, one at age 10, the more their contractures will get worse, and you should anticipate probably they may actually have two periods of time where they actually seem not to respond at all to physical therapy, primarily because they're just growing so darn fast. In fact, as a child grows, the child needs about 6 hours of regular stretch to stretch their muscles. So the growth plate to the muscle is where the tendon connects to the bone, and that adds more cells to the muscle in response to daily movement and daily stretch. And people know that you need about 6 to 8 hours of sustained stretch a day to prevent contracture. What I'm talking about is that in order to keep up the child's growth of their skeleton, you've got to have sustained stretch of those muscles for 6 to 8 hours a day. If you don't do that, then what's going to happen is you have a net loss of the ability for the muscle to keep pace with bone growth. You start getting tighter and tighter and tighter. So that's one of those challenges to deal with, especially since we don't have 6 hours a day to stretch our children. How do we go about trying to get that 6 to 8 hours of stretch so they don't develop contractures as they get older? So I want to focus really most of my talk and talk about the child who has hemiparesis who walks, because I think that's probably what's most important. And I just want to briefly review that, you know, when you take a look at the priorities of the handicapped child, walking really is the last of four things. It's really more important to focus about their daily, their communication. I just stepped in on this very nice talk on communication, daily living activities, mobility, and walking really is the last of four priorities. I think it's important to recognize that for me as an orthopedic surgeon, I probably play the smallest role in care of your child compared to all the other specialists you've seen today. You think about what it takes to walk is very interesting. You have to be able, number one, to stand, okay? You have to be able to stand well without using any support. Number two, you have to be able to pick up one leg. Because when you take a step, you've got to be able to stand on one leg for 1 or 2 seconds or so as you swing the leg forward. You have to be able to pick your leg up enough and bend your knee and bend your hip and pull up your foot so your toes don't drag. You have to be able to bring your leg forward enough so you have a decent stride. Otherwise, you take these little small skipping steps, right? You have to be able to put your foot down in a position where you have balance and stability. And you have to be able to do this over and over again without getting tired. So it's one thing to be able to stand. It's another thing to be able to walk. And that's a huge quantum leap in terms of ability because there's a lot more to get a child to walk as opposed to standing. So the problem, of course, is that after a hemispherectomy, we lose a lot of selective muscle control as part of the surgery as well, right? We also have those abnormal reflexes, which affect our gait patterning. Some of those reflexes may actually precede the surgery. And plus, the decreased balance that we have as a result of surgery affects our ability to stand on that one leg and pick a leg off the floor, swing it forward. And that's a problem. It's funny, you know, because when you talk to an orthopedic surgeon, we'll focus more on your child's legs and hips. And you'll seldom hear us talk about your child's hand and arm. And I'll tell you why. You know, orthopedic surgery traditionally has fallen into spine, foot, leg, and then hand as an afterthought. In fact, for people who do a lot of this, there's a separate subspecialty for orthopedic surgery, which is just hand. And you may find that actually when you see an orthopedic surgeon, he may say that if your child needs something to improve their function of their hand, they may send you to another specialist. But by and large, the reason why that is because God gave us two hands, and if one hand is weak, then the other hand is usually the dominant arm, and most children use the weaker hand as a support or a paperweight or something to push against. And really, the indications for us to intervene in terms of a child's hand are actually pretty minimal. That is, if there's an issue with hygiene, skin breakdown, or function, That's when we interfere and try to intervene. But aside from that, really, we leave a lot of the therapy to the therapists. And if there is a need for intervention, most of the time, unless your surgeon is sufficiently qualified in hand surgery, you can get sent off to another specialist who does pediatric hand surgery. You have to understand, of course, that the gait problems in hemiparesis is primarily the central nervous system, right? But also, you can't forget, there's also time. We talked a little bit already about these issues about tone and balance and coordination. But also, you have to understand that as your child grows and gets heavier and taller, they're a moving target. So to broadly talk about what we do in terms of orthopedic surgery, we think about problems with the soft tissues, problems with the bones, the shape of the bones, and then problems with the joints. And based upon those problems, you can treat them with surgery or braces or physical therapy. So this is a caricature of the typical posturing of a child who has spastic hemiparesis. You see the typical postured arm with their bent wrist and a bent elbow. And then they normally will walk on their toes, maybe on the outer border of their foot. They may drag their foot a little bit. And I think this is an exaggerated picture. I think most children hide this very well because they know what they do. My experience is that a lot of children, if they're coached very carefully, will walk quite well. What you see this is when they're tired or when they run too much or at the end of the day or they're upset. That's when their posture occurs. And this is when you see that it's worse. But this is typically what you see in somebody who's at their worst in terms of spastic hemiparesis. The nice thing about these children is that almost all of them will walk regardless, which is good. And most of the issues which will affect them as adults is primarily going to be the arm. When you take a look at adults in the community who have spastic hemiparesis, either from cerebral palsy or from a stroke, you don't really focus on having a slight foot drag. Most of the time, as adults, we see that the posture of their arm. And that gets to be a little more of a social issue, which we coach to kids and the parents, that your child will actually find ways to accommodate for that as they get older. Such as when you talk to strangers and they know their posture, they may just suddenly put their arm over their wrist and hold their arm down. Or they may put their thumb in their inner pocket, or put it in the back of their jeans, or something like that. These are skills which the children learn by themselves. They may be coached, they may be taught. But it's really more of an upper extremity issue which affects these children as adults, not so much their feet and their legs, okay? So here are the options available to an orthopedic surgeon. We can send them to physical therapy, we can prescribe a brace, or operate. And that's the three broad groups. Really, it's more well-defined in terms of their age. Generally speaking, for children who are less than 5, there really is no role for surgery. And the reason why is because they haven't had enough time to grow yet to the point they develop a contracture. So they're eminently treatable without surgery, primarily with physical therapy and bracing. So when I see a child who's post-hemispherectomy and they're 3 years old, 4 years old, I'm a non-surgery kind of guy. In fact, when you talk to surgeons, you'll find that surgeons fall in two groups. They're the bracers and they're the non-bracers. And depending upon how you feel about that, you may find that you may want to swing from one surgeon to another. So, you know, some surgeons will say, well, if you brace your child, they'll never develop a deformity, and that will protect their joints. The counter-argument to that is that if you always brace your child, they'll never be brace-free, and they'll always be brace-dependent. So what do you really want for your child? So that is a philosophical argument, and there is no answer for that. You simply have to believe basically what your child's capable of and go from there. From age 4 to 8, that's where most of the big work comes in for me as an orthopedic surgeon. I'd say maybe 4 to 10 or so. That's when we really do a lot in terms of treating these children, primarily because they've had their first big growth spurt, and now they start having these problems which occur when they start growing and they don't stretch enough, and they start having problems. This is where you do all the surgeries. This is when you do the bracing. So bracing does work when children are growing, because that's how you get the additional 6 hours of stretch, is you actually hold them in a brace that keeps them in a stretched position. And that's one of the reasons why there is a field that people say that they should brace kids more and less. After children get past age 10 or 12 or so, we don't really talk too much about intervention, more accommodation. Because at this point, the ability for neuroplasticity to compensate for any post-surgical deficit gets less and less and less. So now we begin to shift towards not so much what can we do to improve their function, but what can we do to kind of improve their abilities to work with what we have. So you may find that as your child gets older, you may find that some of the therapists may begin to slow down their visits. You may find insurance companies begin to fight more in terms of providing more approval for therapy, simply because they've seen, at least from the cerebral palsy data, that's all we really have, is that a lot of this intervention doesn't really work once the kids are in their teens. And this is the reason why. So let's talk about bracing. When you talk to orthopedic surgeons, they'll use words like HKAFO, AFO, KFO, RGO, and you wonder what's with all of those. Basically, these acronyms talk about the joints which are immobilized. So the A and the AFO is ankle, the F is the foot, the K is the knee, and the H is the hip. And you just kind of go from head down to foot. So if you've got a brace that goes from hips down to the feet, it's going to be a hip, knee, ankle, foot orthosis, HKAFO, right? And if you have AFO, it's ankle, foot orthosis. And if you have an SMO, that's a supramalleolar, which is basically a high top. Orthosis, and that's why I talk about that. So this brace that you see here controls the knee and ankle and foot, so this is what we call the KAFO. We don't really prescribe these things anymore because they're heavy and they're clunky, and the children don't want to wear them, and it slows them down, and it rips up your couch, and they're horrible. In fact, most people now say that with a good, smaller brace, it does everything you can do with a bigger brace. So it's really not very useful unless you use it at night as a splint. And I think a lot of therapists will recommend a night splint for early contractures, primarily at the knee, for the children to wear, because it allows you to get some passive stretch of the knee as the child sleeps. And so you see somebody who talks about wanting these long braces, you kind of have to say, well, why is this better than a smaller brace? So this is a smaller brace. It's called an AFO, or ankle foot orthosis. And this is 99% of the braces that you'll see children wear. And it's really evolved tremendously as we've known more about how the ankle works and how it's coupled with the movement of the hip and the knee. And if you do something to the ankle, you can actually do a lot to actually affect how the knee moves, not the hip moves. This is the brace. I think this is made by Cascade. And these are light materials. Now, you don't see the kids transitioning to the hard fiberglass materials or a brace with a hinge until they're much older. Why? Well, because they outgrow these darn things. These things are expensive. Number two, they're heavy as you get more sturdy. And number three, when you wonder about, well, where does your child flex when they walk, it actually bends through the bottom part of the hinge right here. They'll flex through the middle part of the foot. That would be the hinge for their ankle. And we can do that for a lot of children simply because it's hard to find shoes that fit over a bulky brace with an ankle joint. So when you see somebody who prescribes an AFO that's rigid, you'll find that oftentimes your child's fault, there won't be a hinge because it actually makes it heavier, makes it more bulky, and kids actually don't like wearing it. When they do incorporate a hinge, a lot of times a hinge will have a stop that keeps your child's foot from dropping too far because toe drag is usually the biggest issue. But those hinges tend to fail a little bit. So this is one of the hinged AFOs. As you can see, there really isn't a hinge per se. It's more like a flexible, elastic strap, which has got some obsolescence and wear and tear is going to fail. But still, it's light, it's not very bulky. And of course, if a child grows it in a year and a half, then it's expendable. But this is an example of the hinged AFO with a nice little stop on the back that keeps a child from dropping their toes too much. You know, there's a balance. When you prescribe a brace for a child, you want to say, well, what am I trying to achieve here? Because if I don't want a child to drag their foot, and I give them a brace which doesn't let their foot drop down, how are they going to be able to push off when they walk heel toe? Right? They start walking like they're little tin men in boots. And that's one of those problems where you try to find out as an orthopedic surgeon, what is the right mix for your child in terms of what's too much stability and not enough flexibility? And that's really the struggle where you try to find a balance between flexibility and stability when you brace a child. These AFOs work great, especially when it comes time for your child to go upstairs, because that's typically where the children trip. They can't pick their foot up enough, they get tired. It does some good stretching for the calf, which helps fight their ankle contractures, and does try to address that stretch reflex that makes them more spastic. So the ideal brace would be one that limits your range of motion just enough to keep you from dragging your foot, but not to a point where it limits your flexibility totally. And if you think about how you and I walk, when we pull our foot up, our brains are programmed to bend our knees back. And when we push our foot down, we're programmed to extend our knees. And that's called a coupled motion. That's one of those higher levels of neurologic patterning, which a therapist works very hard when you try to get the children to actually work, not in terms of single joint therapy, but multiple joint therapy, to get that coupled heel, toe, ankle, foot motion going on. And then when you get near that, now you start talking about coupled motions, you'll talk about motions between the hip flexing and the knee bending and the foot going up at the same time. So you have to think about how that brace affects that. Okay. You may hear about manipulation and splinting and casting. The whole idea, of course, is that this provides sustained stretch, right? And if you provide that stretch for 24/7, then you'll get the muscle to add more cells to the end of the tendon, which makes the muscle longer. If you change those casts every week, you begin to make some incremental improvement in the child's contracture. That works great if your child has a mild degree of tightness. It doesn't work very well if your child's really, really stuck, because sometimes the deficiency in terms of length may be in a span of 3 or 4 inches. And it's not feasible to actually try to stretch a child because it causes a lot of pain. In fact, if you have a child who doesn't get better with 1 or 2 casts, it actually may give some false hope, I think, to the parents. It's really best for those children who are actually do have a contracture and they're not one of these rare variants where they have more of a motion disorder. It does work great for about 6 weeks after the last cast, and typically what happens to children outgrow that corruption and they're tight again. So I don't see cervical casting or manipulation as being the cure. I think it's something that buys you time if you need to buy time for another issue. So if your child for some reason is not stable enough to undergo surgery to lengthen the tendon, you may want to try cervical casting. Or if for some reason they don't do well with anesthesia or some other issues, then cervical casting may have a role for that. You have to be very careful though, because I've seen bad pressure ulcers where you push a child very, very hard and they get pressure sores in the casting. Or you stretch a nerve, now they've got a nerve, foot drop because you stretch the nerve. But I've seen folks who've actually broken children's bones. Yes, ma'am.
Sorry to interrupt, but this is a sore subject for us because our daughter's arch has completely collapsed due to overcasting.
Correct. Well, so what happens is that for a child, you can't pull their foot up because they're tight in the calf. If they have enough flexibility in their ankle joint, they'll turn their foot out and pronate their foot, and they roll onto the inside of their foot. And what happens is that that's how they get their additional mobility. And if you keep on doing that, you actually get that as your primary problem. And to fix that, now you have to fix the tight Achilles tendon and then the fact that now their foot's turned. So when you and I, as adults, get tight in our ankles, a lot of times we'll also pronate and turn out. That's part of the problem we have as adults with plantar fasciitis and heel spurs. But in a growing child, it's much worse. And this is a problem. So to your point, I think that somebody who's doing this needs to check your child pretty regularly to be sure that they're not creating a secondary deformity. We do a lot of Botox injections for these kids. As outpatient, because it lets you decrease the spasticity for about 3 or 4 months. It lets you probably do a little bit more with cervical casting. So if you're a neurologist or orthopedic surgeon feels comfortable with adjunctive Botox injections, we do that a lot to try to treat those kids, especially the kids who are less than 5, because they do so well. So surgery, this is where we come in. I think it's important for you to understand that we as orthopedic surgeons really try to not talk about the surgery every summer for your daughter or every Christmas, because we understand that for every surgery, there's long recovery. For every surgery, there's 6 weeks in a cast. For every surgery, there's a loss of your motor milestones. So we don't want to do that. And if your surgeon may say, listen, we're going to fix the ankle. We may actually want to fix the hip and the knee as well. And we're not trying to make money so we can pay off our cars. We're trying to actually say that it's actually better for your child because it's one recovery, one convalescence, We don't want to fall into that anniversary syndrome. Oh, it's summertime again. Let's fix this. It's summertime. We'll plan this for next Christmas. That's not what we want to do. We want to actually work the entire extremity at one time and fix it all at once. And also, we have to be very realistic in terms of what you can expect out of the surgery. So that's important. There's a small subset of children who actually aren't spastic. They actually have movement disorders. They're atonic or dystonic. Those kids you can't do orthopedic surgery on because their motion pattern changes by the moment. And when you do a surgery like this, you have these really bad effects because you don't actually get the desired effects you want. So that's a big problem. So the principles I use is that if you see your child is beginning to have a problem, try to really hit them hard in physical therapy to brace to forestall surgery until at least after a first growth spurt. So if your child is 3 or 4, really has some problems, really ramp up therapy and bracing. Try to get past the first growth spurt, and then do your surgery because you know that they'll at least get 4 or 5 years out of that surgery. The other thing is that most children who are less than 6 or 8 really don't do very well with physical therapy. Aggressive is good after surgery. So you need to have a child who's mature enough and has attention span long enough that you work well with therapists. So you try to delay surgery until that age. We also have to understand, too, that sometimes the bones are actually affected, and we may have to adjust those as well. So if you have a gait lab next to close to you in your state, highly recommend you get your child analyzed in a gait lab. I think in Florida, it is all of, I believe, 2. Because a lot of this, in terms of trying to figure out what's bad muscle, is very hard to figure out, even if you have somebody who watches your child over and over again. Sometimes you actually have to do the high-speed camera and the myography to figure it out. Unfortunately, gait analysis, as some of you may already know, may or may not be reimbursed by insurance, may or may not be available in the community. So it's nice to be able to have it if you can actually get yourself analyzed in the gait lab. I highly recommend. So the principles are, we talked about, of course, is correct everything on one leg at one time, okay? And do it all in one stop. And if your child has both legs affected, we're gonna do everything at one time, even though it means it's gonna be a huge amount of aftercare for the 6 weeks after surgery. It's better in the long run to put your child through surgery just once. Here's the big thing. How do you know whether or not your child simply has hypertonicity or true contracture? So again, if your child just has a muscle which is spastic, you'll know because when you put stretch on their limb, after about 10 seconds, it'll give, and you'll get all the flexibility back. That's spasticity. That doesn't need orthopedic surgery. You probably can deal with either oral antispasmodics like baclofen or tizanidine. You can think about rhizotomy or fecal pump. It's when the children have contracture, where no matter how much you put stretch in their joint, it never gives, that's where you need surgery. And sometimes it's hard to really know whether or not your child has 50% spasticity in the muscle, 50% contracture. So there are times where I may say, well, let's try Botox and steroid casting for 6 weeks. And if your child still doesn't pull all the way up, then probably it's a contracture. You're going to need surgery. I think that's probably a better approach than just saying that every nail needs a hammer, every child has got spasticity and surgery. There's a lot of ability for us to actually use a gait lab to figure out exactly where the problem is in terms of spasticity versus contracture. Anyway, orthopedically, we deal with either we lengthen muscles, or we transfer muscles, or we cut muscles. Okay. Now, when you lengthen the muscle, what you're trying to do is you're trying to basically just restore the length of the tendon to where it's supposed to be, and that's it. Also, what happens, unfortunately, is you also weaken the muscle, because muscles have their own resting length, which makes them work at their maximum degree of strength. And when you make the muscle too long, it takes about 6 months for them to actually get back to where they were before. Now, that may be good if your child walks on their toes, but all you want to do is not have them walk on their toes, in which case, being weak in the calf for 6 months would not be a bad thing. But if your child is walking and you want to do surgery to lengthen their hamstrings, what it means they won't be able to bend their leg back and bend their knee for 6 months. That may mean that they don't want to walk as much because they can't support their knee, which is a big deal. And this is an example of what we do when we link to the Achilles tendon. And the two weeks, this is how most people do it. Take a look at the figure to your left. What's being done is that three little poke holes are made through the skin, and the tendon's cut halfway through in three different spots. And if you notice, the tendon's only cut halfway through on the inside, above and below, cut in the middle. The reason why is because no muscle fiber actually gets cut more than once if you do it this way. So you're only cutting the muscle once. And when you stretch the ankle, what happens is that those muscle fibers will slide, and that's how you get your length back. It's a very elegant surgery because, in terms of recovery, it's just three little poke holes in one stitch, and there's really nothing in terms of scarring or blood loss. And you can get probably about 20 to 25, 30 degrees of correction of the surgery. The rub is you can only do it once. When a child heals, they heal scar tissue, and now if your child needs another surgery, they can't do it anymore because nothing will slide. I used to tell parents that if we do this surgery in a child, expect 4 or 5 years, maybe 6 years, but they probably will outgrow their surgery when they have no growth spurt before puberty, in which case you probably would expect that they may need to have this done a second time. But once you have this done a second time, when they're 13 or 14, they probably won't even have this done ever again as an adult. Yes, ma'am.
So a lot of our kids go into very early puberty.
Right.
Especially my son. So we just did hip, and I don't mean to interrupt you, I'm sorry, but hip and bilateral foot surgery. And now the whole hamstring is in contraction. He's in Tanner stage 4. He's almost at stage 5.
Yes.
He's only 10. What do we wait for the growth plate to stop?
No, I don't think so. I think if your child's really at that point, you should probably have a surgery. There's really no merit in waiting until they're old enough, because if your child's having a functional problem and nothing else works, then that is the time to do the surgery. I think, you know, the overall goal is really function. And remember I said that immobility causes the spasticity to get worse. So the last thing you want to do is have your child not be able to be mobile. And the global care of the child with hemiparesis, that's actually worse as it's slowing down. But that's a good point, though. Yes.
If you said you can only do this surgery once they hit the puberty age and they have a second growth spurt, what is the second surgery?
Second surgery involves an incision. It's basically 2 inches long. We physically cut the tendon in two, and you lengthen it to where you want the sword back together. So you still get the same. It's the same procedure, but it's a little bit more of more surgery. The recovery is still the same. It's just that now it's a bigger incision. But there's a point of diminishing returns. To a point that every time you do surgery, you create more scar tissue. And every time you cut scar tissue, it heals more scar tissue. And that scar tissue doesn't contract, doesn't stretch, it actually makes you worse. So that's why we're very sparing when it comes to finding out you recommend surgery, because we know that surgery causes scars, scars not function. So we don't want to the point where your child has tremendously straight legs, but nothing actually is very strong and actually moves. We really want to be very judicious in terms of recommending surgery. Okay, the second thing that we can do is we can actually transfer a muscle. And this is typically in children who have spasticity around their knees, where they either don't bend their knees when they walk like the Tin Man, or they never get their legs straight when they walk, you know, it's a crutch. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to transfer a muscle that works to replace a muscle that doesn't work. Typically, if the muscle that doesn't work is the back of the knee, you'll take a muscle from the knee, and you'll move it to the back, and vice versa. It works well, so long as you're very, very confident that you know that the muscle you're transferring actually is spastic. And that's difficult to assess. The other problem, of course, is that the child has to be able to move that muscle or control that muscle volitionally in order to be able to train their brain to work the muscle again. Otherwise, what happens is you just create a static bridle that keeps your leg from moving. The other problem with muscle transfer is that every time you transfer a muscle, you also lose 1 grade of strength. So if 3 grade strength would be at least from 0 to 5. So if you have a muscle that's very strong, you transfer it, you normally lose 1 grade of strength. You never get the strength back. So that's a pretty big deal. We do this a lot as well around the hip. And the last thing that we do is called tenotomy. And I think that maybe a lot of your children's more experience of talking about a tenotomy. Tenotomy is when you just cut the muscle. And when you cut it in half, what you do is you release the tendon. got some advantages and disadvantages. When you cut the tendon in a growing child, the tendon actually grows back together, and you keep the ends still and immobilize them for 6 weeks. So it may seem really horrible to think about somebody cutting your tendons in half and telling you you're going to be fine, but if you do it in such a way that you preserve circulation to the tendon and you keep the child's legs basically immobilized, that gap will fill in with new tissue. And in time, those two ends of the tendon will actually be continuous again. So for some of the muscles that we do, that actually is very viable, especially the muscles where the tendons are too small to actually make those three long cuts. We just simply cut them in half, we mobilize them. There are some muscles where there is no tendon. The tendon is actually inside the muscle, in which case what I would do is I'd simply cut the tendon within the muscle. Now the muscle fibers stretch and everything heals. And that's particularly common around the hip as well. The problem with when you cut a muscle, and there's an old term I was taught, is that when you deal with a child with spasticity and you cut one spastic muscle, you may find that you've also uncovered another spastic muscle that you never saw that pulls them back the opposite way. So spasticity masks spasticity, which is what I was taught to say, is that if your child, for instance, crouches because their hamstrings are tight, you may actually not realize the fact that when you lengthen their hamstrings, their quadriceps are up very tight, and now their legs are too straight. And so now you start chasing yourself, trying to figure out exactly, you know, what is the culprit, and that's one of the problems. And finally, we talk about bony procedures. And this is typically more exclusively for the hip and the thigh problems. They fall basically into four different choices. Most of the issues we deal with in children who need this is usually osteotomy, where you actually cut the bone and you reorient the ball so it goes into a socket and you put a plate or a screw in place. You see an example of somebody who's had this, and they'll put a plate and screws in. And a lot of these actually are great, but in children, they require 6 weeks in a cast. And the 6 weeks in the cast is necessary because those plates aren't strong enough to withstand the forces of your child's spasticity or their body weight. And we need the cast to help the bones heal without things coming loose. Now, the other reason why is because the children are oftentimes extremely painful once they're kept immobilized in the cast. And the cast gives you that circumferential splint which keeps them comfortable. The bad thing about the cast is that they're also severely stiff and very weak after you come out of the cast. And many times by the time you've got them back to their baseline, they now are just as tight as they were before you started. And this is the problem when you deal with a teenager who needs orthopedic surgery. Now, remember I said that when you're 10 or older, we don't generally don't do orthopedic surgery. Why? Well, say your four-year-old child needs surgery for their hamstrings. It's easy for you to care for them in their cast because they're light, you can pick them up, you can move them around. And of course, after they come out of the cast, it's very easy for them to bounce back and regain their flexibility or mobility. What if your child's 16 and they're 150 pounds and now they're in the same cast? All of a sudden, you can't pick them up. Now you can't put them on the toilet. He won't fit into your car because his leg's straight. And once he comes out of the cast, he's so stiff and so weak, he may take 9 months to get his strength back. And in that time, he stops walking, he sits in his wheelchair. By the time he gets his strength back, now he's tight and loose again. Okay? and that's the reason why pediatric orthopedic surgeons will try to say, well, when your child's a teenager, we're not really talking about trying to get them straight again. We're trying to try to make them more functional than what they have, simply because the cure is worse than the problem on these issues. This is an example of a dislocated hip where it's become arthritic. It's basically fused to the pelvis. There's no flexibility in this at all. And sometimes the only thing we can do if a child actually has arthritis in a joint is cut the bones apart, put them back in a functional position, and fuse them back again. And this is typically in an older child who's got a foot problem where the foot's turned out. And now it's not stretchable. Now you say, well, I can fix your child's foot, but now we're going to have to start fusing joints together. It's one of those things. You know, orthopedic surgery is a balance between flexibility and stability. You and I function in perfect balance. We're just as flexible as we need to be, just as stable as we need to be, right? So what happens when your child has a problem? Well, they're hyper-flexible, but they're not very stable. What happens after orthopedic surgery? You may be hyper-stable, not flexible at all. And this is the give and take when you think about this, which is a problem. A lot of children, if they have a problem with this, we actually would recommend just removing the ball of the hip. And this, as you can see, is a tremendous picture because the total ball of the hip is just destroyed. And there's bone spurs and everything. You see that joint replacements in parentheses. The reason why is because you don't do joint replacements in children because they simply wear them out and they'll destroy them. So we try to delay any kind of joint replacement surgery until they're in their, hopefully in their teens, late teens, early 20s, where they're smart enough to realize they can't try to wear out those joints. So total hip replacement really is in parentheses because you can't do that in an active young individual. They simply don't last beyond 4 years. So hip problems are few and not very common after hemispherectomy. But again, if you've got a problem with one hip's tight, usually the other hip's tight in the opposite direction. And when you work on one hip and you make that flexible, usually the other hip now is tight. So one of the biggest things is that you may have to actually think about when you do one hip, you actually have to do both hips so you balance the soft tissues. And we don't really do a lot of these surgeries because a lot of these problems they have with their hips are actually more dynamic, not static, which is a big deal. And we talked a little about some of these surgeries already where you can cut the tendon, transfer the tendon. But most of the time, your surgeon may say we should probably do both sides because if you just do the side that's bad, the other side will actually get worse. And that's the reason why. Again, gait analysis is important because of the fact that multiple joints work together. So the hip and the knee and the ankle work together as a trio. And if you think that your problem just has a tight knee and they can't get the leg straight, it's probably a little more sophisticated than that. And the problem is that when your child crouches and they crouch like this, how do you know it's not an issue that their quads aren't strong enough? You may assume maybe just their hamstrings are tight, but maybe their calves aren't strong enough, and because their calves aren't strong enough, they can't point their feet down. So as a result, they sag in their ankles, so they have to bend their knees. Or maybe their hips are tight. Because their hips are tight, now they can't get their hips straight, so now they have to bend their knees. Otherwise, they'll bend forward at the waist. So these issues become very vexing when we start talking about that, which is a big deal. So typically, stiff knee gait is one of the things which we look for in children who have hemispherectomies. Is when you walk, does your child actually bend their knee when they're picking it up and swinging through the air? That's the biggest thing. If they can do that, that's great. If they can't, that's the most biggest reason why the children drag their feet on the ground is because they don't bend their knees when they swing through the air. There's not a brace that works to help your child bend their knee when that's in the air, because all braces only work when your child's foot's on the ground. So that's where you start talking about muscle transfers to help bend the knee during the swing phase, rather than bracing, which is a big deal. But as you can see what happens here in the figure on the far left side, is that the muscle's actually cut.
Right here. And it actually transfers
it
back to the knee.
So now when the child tries to straighten the leg, that one muscle actually pulls the leg back. And that's called a rectus transfer. The reason why that works is because there are actually four muscles which comprise the quadriceps, right? That's why it's called quadriceps. So three muscles left behind is satisfactory, so you can actually do this there as well. This crouched gait issue, this is the biggest thing that actually haunts us in terms of trying to figure out what's what. So as you see, knees are bent, hips are bent, and it's a very hard position to try to walk long distances. If any of you have actually tried to walk without locking your knees, it's hard to walk without locking your knees. It's hard to stand all day without locking your knees. It's very, very tiring. So if you can just get the knees to come straight and the child to lock their knees, it increases their endurance tremendously, right? And the surgery for that actually is to cut or lengthen the hamstring tendons behind the knees to get them straight. It works very well. The problem is, of course, is that these muscles tend to get tight against your child grows, and typically you warn the parents that probably will have them done again in 3 to 5 years. The problem with this surgery and most surgeries in the legs is that each muscle in the leg doesn't just cross one joint. Each muscle in the leg crosses two joints. Some muscles in the leg crosses three joints. So now when you cut the muscle that makes the knee bent, like the hamstrings, that muscle anchors to your pelvis. And that muscle is supposed to keep your pelvis straight so you can stand up straight. So So what happens is if you cut the hamstring tendon so your child doesn't crouch, now nothing keeps their pelvis from tilting back. Now they stand like this with their butt sticking back. And now they start walking like this, okay? Which is a problem when you do the surgery. So when you start talking about why is my child crouched, you have to ask yourself, well, it's because their hips don't come straight, or their knees don't come straight, or their ankles don't push down. And this is an issue. You need to really be careful when you analyze these kids, because you need to avoid these problems when you do these surgeries. All right, let's talk about the feet. This is where 99% of the post-hemispherectomy kids have problems with. They don't really crouch too much. Those are really minor issues. They're very seldom have any hip problems at all. It's really the foot and the foot position. And I've been fortunate enough to see every single hemispherectomy patient that's been treated in our hospital for the last 5 years. And we've been watching every year with x-rays and evaluation by me. And I've done very little in the way of any other surgery besides surgery to the foot and ankle, which is really, really good. These are the easiest ones to hide and mask when the child wears big shoes. So a typical story I get is, well, my child wears shoes and he doesn't walk on his toes anymore. Well, how do you know? He's not walking his toes inside his shoes, right? That's the problem. And the biggest deal is, what constitutes a good-looking foot? Well, for me, as long as the foot's flexible and it's braceable and it's flat on the ground, that's a good-looking foot. I don't care if it turns out or turns in a little bit. As long as it's flexible and it's braceable and it's flat on the ground, that's a good foot. All right? That's a little bit hard to convince some families who want a perfectly normal foot, in which case they may have to talk about being a little bit more realistic in terms of expectations. Because you can do a lot with a foot that's flexible, but you can't do a lot with a straight foot that's stiff, which is a problem. So we do a lot of tendon surgeries, and you may hear people talk about these surgeries to call a splat and a splot surgery. So if you hear the doctor talk about a splat or a splot, they're talking about taking the tendon, splitting it in half, which is the SP, okay, and they're transferring it to another part of the foot. And typically what happens is when you split a tendon, you'll transfer a tendon through the bones to the front of the ankle to give strength to the opposite side of the ankle. It works quite well for a child who's got just this problem. And when done well, it's a terrific surgery. You can also do the surgery for the same thing by splitting the muscle in the back of the ankle. That's called a splat. So this muscle here originally fixes to the big toe and pulls your foot up. Now, unfortunately, because it attaches to the big toe, it also turns your foot onto the side when you pull your foot up. Now, in you and I, it doesn't happen because we have other muscles which actually keeps the foot from turning onto the side. That muscle doesn't work in children who have hemiparesis. So what we'll do is we'll split it in half and transfer half of it to the outside of the foot. So now it pulls just like a bridle, just like a stirrup. Yes? Correct.
Okay.
Right.
That's
yep.
Why I'm on the head. So
yep.
And he's older, he's 40.
Yes. Right.
So, already you don't have to worry about bone growth.
Right.
Body growth. Is the surgical, is that an option?
It would be an option. The big thing is, can he demonstrate that muscle actually works? So that's the biggest thing is that, can your child demonstrate that they actually have control of that muscle volitionally to make it pull up? And that's the difficult thing. A lot of these children may not have very good control of the muscle that you want to transfer. So if you transfer it, does it actually function to pull your foot up? Or is it more just a static stirrup to keep your foot straight? Now, this surgery does work well, even as a static stirrup, even if it means that your child is able to have a foot that's straight and doesn't need a brace. That actually works very well. So, right, without an ankle fusion. So. You know, we talk about doing this to preserve mobility, but sometimes just to get your child so that they're more functional without a brace, this works quite well. And this is for a drop foot, it's a drop foot surgery. So this previous surgery I spoke about here is a surgery where the child walks on the outside of the foot. And what you're trying to do there is try to keep the foot straight. The splat surgery, which is a split tibialis anterior, is in front of the foot. So that's basically what we talk about. So what do you do, right? The big thing, of course, is that if their foot's flexible, then all these surgeries will work. If their foot's stiff and nothing makes it move, then it's probably not a muscle problem. It's usually they're arthritic. Now you need to have a bony surgery, which is going to be some kind of a fusion of the foot. So again, if the foot's flexible, you're terrific. If your foot's stiff and it doesn't move and it's really in the bones, then all this orthopedic soft tissue surgery doesn't work. They're probably going to have a bony surgery. It'll actually be a fusion surgery. That's probably what report was told to you. toe walking. A lot of kids walk their toes. What was your question in the back? These surgeries are very rare, and I'm talking about them only so for completeness sake, but they're not very, very common. The biggest surgery we do is just the lengthening of the Achilles. The lengthening of the Achilles addresses probably 90% of the issues that we see in post-hemispherectomy kids. Yeah. Well, physical. Are there any physical therapists here in the room? No. There are great physical therapists who are tremendous advocates for a child. They're liaison between a surgeon and a doctor and a family because they understand both sides, and they're the person who's the cheerleader and the spokesman for the patients. But then there are the physical terrorists. And the physical terrorists are the ones that do a lot to unravel some good work. And the reason why I think both therapists exist is because there's not a lot of good concrete data that shows what works in physical therapy. There's a lot of physical therapy data that shows that this therapy works good, this therapy works good, this therapy works good, this therapy works good. You know? And the issue is that if there are 15 different ways of physical therapy, what it means is that nobody really knows what's the way to fix it. Okay, if there's only one way to fix a problem, then I think people have reached consensus that's the way to fix it. But anytime you see anything in medicine where people have 15 different ways to fix the same problem, what it means is that nobody knows what's the way to fix the problem. And the only way to really know what's the best way to think about that is to actually say, well, where's the peer-reviewed literature that shows that there's been a controlled study that's done with thousands of kids, you can actually say there's been a statistical difference between the trial group and the control group. That study was done in the 1980s. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, and it showed that there was a questionable effect of physical therapy compared to kids who just had regular play and exercise. Now, I said this about 10 years ago. I almost got lynched. And I see this very carefully because physical therapists are tremendous helps. It's a tremendous help for us. But you have to be, as consumers, you have to be very conscious to ask and question, why is this necessary? What are you trying to achieve? And what is the science and what's the research that proves that this actually is worthwhile? And if you find a surgeon or a therapist that can't cite for you that, here, this is the paper, or this is the study, or this is the textbook, then you have to say, well, is it just anecdotal experience that you're working on? And if that's the case, do we really want to treat children with anecdotal experience? I don't know, maybe not. That's the problem. So to answer your question, that's the question. Now to answer your question about the splinting at night, there's no harm in splinting a child at night because they're asleep. And if it's a passive stretch, remember you need 6 to 8 hours of passive stretch a day, then that's an easy 6 hours of time. Okay. So night splinting is awesome as long as your child wears a splint. Yes, if they don't wear the splint, then you have to duct tape the splint. Okay, or creatively, yeah. And that's where serial casting works. Serial casting basically is 24/7 splinting, right? With perfect compliance. That's the kind of the leap from splinting to casting. Anyway, this is basically the lengthening we do for the Achilles. You can see how we cut it in three different spots. And it works pretty darn well, so long as you don't over-lengthen it. If you over-lengthen this muscle, what happens is now if they can't actually stand on their toes, when they stand, they actually crouch because their foot goes all the way up. And that oftentimes can be a problem as well. So we talked a little bit about two joint muscles. Okay, scoliosis. Everybody fears that your child's going to get scoliosis or hysterectomy. Okay? Again, when I looked at PubMed 2 weeks ago, I found no articles talking about this at all. I searched hemispherectomy, spine, hemispherectomy scoliosis, hemispherectomy gait, nothing. There's nothing in literature about scoliosis and hemispherectomy. But in children who are more profoundly affected, because they've got no head control and trunk control, they do get scoliosis, okay? Which is a big deal. Now, the thing is that those children who can stand and can walk, they actually never get scoliosis. It means anything because they have good trunk control, right? And if you have good trunk control, what that means is that you basically won't get scoliosis because everything works. And because almost all children with surgical hemiparesis will walk and have good trunk control eventually, scoliosis in this population is an exceedingly rare problem. In fact, the study I'm doing with Dr. Lee in our hospital is actually getting a spine x-ray every single post-hemispherectomy kid every year for 5 years to see. Okay, I have one patient out of probably 200 kids that actually has a curvature. And as their children...
Like, is there a percent that you consider...
Yes, absolutely. Anything less than 10 degrees or so is not actually scoliosis, okay? Anything which is posturally correctable, that if you just tell the child to stand up straight and their scoliosis is better, that's postural control. That's post-hemispherectomy weakness, which you know is going to get better as they get stronger. It's the scoliosis that's 25, 45 degrees. That's a problem. It's the ones that don't get better, no matter how you position the patient. If you've got an x-ray on their back, on their side, it's still the same. That's the bad scoliosis. Question?
Yeah, my daughter told me this more amount of the ball. She doesn't have trunk control. So far, since she has more positional functions, so she can still strengthen her.
Yes.
So are you talking about moving beyond that at some point into something that's not posturally correctable by an outside and not on herself?
Right. So right, it's those The children who are relying on their wheelchair for most of their mobility, who don't stand and walk, those are the ones who are really worried about, does your scoliosis get worse? Now, a lot of these children who have hemispherectomy, who develop scoliosis, weren't walking before they had surgery anyway. So this is a problem when you start talking about where's the data and literature on this. Well, the problem is that if you have children who have scoliosis as part of hemispherectomy, the big question is how many of them had it before they had their surgery? How many of them were walking before the surgery or not walking after surgery? How many of these patients are still not walking after surgery? And because there isn't enough numbers to actually show that, and nobody gets an x-ray of these kids before they have their surgery. Nobody gets an x-ray of these kids after surgery. There's no information. And that's why we're doing this at our hospitals. We're trying to do this because they're asking some science. And that's why there is no paper. I'm planning on this at all. But if your child can stand and they can't walk, then I'll reassure you that this is not an issue. It's the children who can't stand and can't walk, but that really is an issue. And that's where research is going to go. And usually if your child has bad scoliosis, like this child here who has a back foot pump, normally they also have hip problems, knee problems, foot problems. You won't see the child who has scoliosis and nothing else. The children who have bad scoliosis usually have such profound spasticity, they're seeing you for multiple things. You're not going to see a child who just has scoliosis and nothing else. So if your child has no orthopedic problem, then they don't have scoliosis. If your child has an orthopedic problem that's significant, like a hip problem, they probably may have scoliosis, and that's a problem. All right, so what are the take-home points of this? Well, if your child hasn't been seen regularly by a pediatric orthopedist, I recommend they are seen annually by a pediatric orthopedist. And I'd say that you should probably have them seen at least for 5 years after surgery, just to be sure that if there is an incipient problem, they're monitored, and early intervention can be done with soft tissue surgery before they start having bony surgery. A second thing is that if they have a relapse of their seizure activity, that usually resets the whole game, and that's a big problem. So that's an issue. Most problems can be treated without surgery. Like I said, bracing and physical therapy works very, very effectively. For the kids who are high-functioning, hemiparetics, almost all the children do walk, and they do walk well with very minimal bracing. If they do walk with a brace, maybe it's just an AFO. And most of the problems, at least in these children, usually involve just a foot and ankle. Yes?
Thank you very much. We'll take 3 questions, and then we're way over time, so.
Okay. Go ahead.
What general guidelines
for leg length? Yes. So most leg length discrepancies are not that significant. Most of them are usually in a realm of about an inch or less. And the reason why we do get leg length discrepancies is usually because of some lack of neurologic stimulation as your child grows, right? So the way I explain to my families is that, well, if your child walks well, if it's a slightly short leg, and they don't trip over their toes, what if you made their foot or leg an inch longer? Are they going to trip on their toes now? Probably. Okay? So some of that leg discrepancy actually is quite functional, because maybe that's all it needs for them to not drag that toe on the ground when they're tired. You make that leg an inch longer, now they're dragging their foot more. The other thing is that when we talk about a leg discrepancy, that's how you and I stand with our knees together and our legs locked straight. And the reality is that we don't do that. We don't ever do that unless we're told to do that. All of us will cock one leg and do this, or we'll stand like this. And that's the reason why we have these floor mats or cushions when we stand and walk, because that's how our bodies adjust. So having a discrepancy that's meaningful has to be at least more than an inch for it to be a problem. If the discrepancy is less than an inch, then you easily accommodate that, and it's not really functional. Yeah, so most discrepancies, you'd like to try to get them fixed before they're done growing, because when you try to do a surgery to correct your leg length discrepancy, it's easy to do it when it's sore growing, because you slow down the growth of a longer leg, and you do it while it's sore growing, so the short leg catches up. If they're 15 years old, there's no catching up. They're not going to be able to grow enough for one leg. You got to do it when they're about 12, okay? So I'd say 12 or 13. Okay.
Brandy?
So you're right, a spine fusion surgery halts your growth. And we don't recommend that in children who are less than 10, because there's some issues about how's the body trying to grow in the rods in the back. But there are rods which expand as your child grows. And the rod that we use now is called a magic rod. It's called a magnetically activated rod. These are temporary rods which are put into the spine. And it's actually lengthened in the office 3 times a year with an electric motor. So the children who are less than 10 years old, who've got scoliosis of 150 degrees, they qualify for a magic rod placement.
How?
Less than 10 years old. Less than 10 with a curve of 150 degrees. Yep. So magic, M-A-G-E-C. Magic rod. It's a magnetic growing rod for the spine. It's a wonderful surgery to do. It's 2 small incisions and a one-night stay in the hospital. And this surgery is actually done in such a way that as a child grows, you don't have to take them back to surgery to make them the rod longer. It's actually done in the office with a magnetic device that just activates the rod. So, but most hospitals don't encourage you to use it because the devices are $17,000 per device. You need 2 of them. And because the hospitals can't recoup that cost, it ends up even the cost of the device. So, but the surgeon's hospital may actually discourage the use of that device. The basis is not cost effective for the hospital.
Now, do you have any suggestions
about traction or scoliosis? I mean, is that able to think? I mean, I don't know if they're tentative after. Yes. Yes, the traction treatment is good, but it's pretty barbaric if you've ever seen it. And I'd say that for somebody who needs surgery, who's very, very stiff, that may be a good thing. But it's most places will require you being transferred for 6 weeks to 3 months for surgery. The purpose of traction is trying to get the spine more flexible so you can actually get it straight with surgery. It's not really meant as a substitute for surgery, it's meant as an adjunct to surgery.
One last question.
Sure.
Eeny, meeny, miny, moe.
I'll let Daphne ask,
and then you can stick around after.
Yeah.
Okay, Daphne.
There is no surgery to make the knee tighter in the back. There are a lot of knees to make surgeries make the knee more flexible in the back. So the thing is you need to fix it before it gets so loose that it's not controllable. That's one of those more aggressive things that you need to be very much more proactive in terms of limiting that from happening. Because as that stretches out, as you get older, you can't fix it. It's not fixable. And your child will have to wear a longer brace, a KAF. Yeah, that's absolutely right. So I have to look at his AFO to see to basically how they built it. So a lot of times to fix that, they'll actually put a heel lift in the AFO, a big one, so that when he walks, he actually touches his knee. Yeah. So gait analysis may help to see whether or not his quads are too strong. And maybe he can do a selective muscle transfer of one's quads and make it weaker. So a rectus transfer may help him.
Thank you
okay,
so
sure.
Much.
Thanks.